this is an interesting interview from a whistleblower from a company, a tech company. I believe it's in Seattle, Washington. But he talks about how they used these frequency technologies on civilian populations who were completely oblivious to it. He said they even experimented like they were guinea pigs on entire cities with mood alteration with the frequencies. And you know, these ELF waves and stuff, they're completely undetectable. You wouldn't know it. And some of the other frequencies are detectable. People think, oh, I hear a ringing in my ears or I have tinnitus. And you know, that's pretty common. I've heard of radio hosts, one of the radio hosts on Coast to Coast had to resign his position because his tinnitus got so bad. So that leads into this targeted individual theory that there are people all over this country and other countries who are claiming that they are targeted individuals of electronic harassment. And granted, I've researched it quite a bit for years and years and years, and I will give you that a lot of the stuff that I've seen, these people are, I believe, are mentally ill. And they aren't targeted, they are paranoid. And which in a sense is the same technology, because when you're targeted by these evil spirits, these, you know, that give you things like schizophrenia, and you still hear voices, it may not be voice to skull technology, but you're still hearing voices. So these entities in these higher dimensions, they're ahead of us in these, you know, the human race is just rediscovering these technologies that you can, you know, influence thought patterns and all of this type of thing. But these entities in these other realms, we've known for millennia, you know, from the Bible, that they do influence thoughts, and they can actually put voices in your head. Now we term it schizophrenia, or if you are, you know, have multiple spirit possessions, then it's multiple personality disorder and things like that. But those are still real. These people are really being harassed. But I believe that a lot of these people's problem is spiritual. And so that's just my take on it. That's just my opinion. You know, you're entitled to your own. But talking about the human race rediscovering these technologies and how it's so easy to hack the human brain. And they've done it. They've hacked the human brain, and we kind of want to pretend it's not going on, because to admit that it is going on is terrifying, to think that somebody remotely, wirelessly, you know, from vast distances can be hacking your brain and putting thoughts in your brain, affecting your moods. Now, I'll put the links below to the videos we've done before about these frequency technologies. There's a lot of interesting stuff in there, including the actual hertz ranges. It gives the numbers, the hertz at which your brain will feel paranoia, fear, you know, all of these, you know, everything to influencing, from mood to sexual behavior to everything. And so there's a lot of that information in there. And then there's a ton of information about, like, you know, the military industrial complex using these technologies. So anyway, I'll put all those videos below, and the ones about the Cuba attack where they frequency attacked people, and going back to Moscow all the way back to the 1970s, where they beamed, and that was proven, they were a building away beaming these frequencies. So the communist enemy has been testing this stuff on Americans for a long time. So in the 70s, they proved it. They traced it back to the building. They were beaming it on the American embassy, and all of our people working there were getting cancer and really sick. And then we've seen that recently in Cuba as well. And then we also saw the frequency technology where they flew over the U.S. ship and did like a mini EMP type thing just from a small box and an unarmed, quote unquote, plane. So these technologies are real. And the communists and the other countries are using them against us. And, you know, that might be an idea to kick around about these chemtrails. Maybe this is our country's answer. Maybe Britain and America are using these chemtrails to bounce back this technology that's being beamed at us from satellite, from an enemy. We don't really know. But, you know, you have to admit that the truth movement is infiltrated. So the standard idea of what chemtrails are, we don't know if that's really real. And I'm not defending the government and saying, oh, they would never be corrupt and they would never hurt us. Clearly, there are studies where they have used us as guinea pigs throughout all of American history. But I am saying that we need to keep in mind, if they're not telling us about these technologies, then, you know, maybe this is, maybe that's what chemtrails are. Maybe we are in this high tech frequency war, and that's the shield they're putting over our cities and stuff when these frequencies are being beamed at. Another example is the bird die-offs, those birds just falling out of the sky. It's no coincidence that every time we have one of these, it's very species specific, you'll notice, and that it's organ specific. They'll say, well, you know, when they were examined, all of the birds had trauma, but they didn't run into anything, you know, but it was trauma in a specific organ, like all of their livers were, you know, had looked like they had trauma and were bleeding, you know, all of their eyes were bleeding, things like that. So that's what frequencies do, because, you know, every organ in your body resonates at a different frequency, and every human resonates at a different frequency, you know, and, you know, but we have groups, species groups that resonate, and you'll see that with the fish die-offs and the bird die-off, and we've seen it with other things, with elk and different animals. But the point is that every time we see these die-offs, it's not all the animals in the area die, like they drank poison water or something, there's raccoons dead and everything else. No, it's very species specific and usually organ specific, which is a sign of this frequency technology, that these birds, perhaps a flock of birds, flew through one of these beam where they were beaming these frequencies down on a town, and that, and those frequencies, you know, caused their organs to burst or whatever. So this is what's happening. This guy goes into gang stalking and all of these other things. Like I said, don't disregard it just because you've seen a few people who are paranoid, who, you know, are not experiencing this. Please don't disregard this. This is a real phenomenon that's happening. They are testing these technologies unwittingly on humans. So, anyway, here's the whistleblower's testimony. Take it or leave it.
I just wanted to say thank you to everyone. I'm sure you can imagine how difficult of a decision this was for me to decide to speak out publicly. And the support I've received has confirmed to me that I did make the right decision. And of course, it was very much needed given the severity of the problem that's sweeping the country right now in terms of gang stalking and voice to skull. So I just wanted to take the time to say that. Yeah, I began working at SIS. Actually, I have friends and family members who are military and military intelligence. And through them, I had always heard, you know, job opportunities. I thought about joining the Marines when I was younger, when I was 18. I'm 39 now. So over the years, it was something I had always thought about. And of course, after 9/11, so many jobs were created in the defense industries, homeland security, and what a lot of people don't know about is within private security, domestically within the United States. It's a booming industry. It's one of the fastest growing sectors of our economy, as generally our society is being militarized, and generally that militarization is being privatized. And as a result, what you have is many, many corporations in the United States of America and private companies that are getting a lot of money from investors under the table to begin to set up what I describe as a security apparatus around and within the United States of America. And it is in that context that I heard of the opportunity to work for security industry specialists in Seattle, Washington. They're a private security company that is headquartered in Culver City, California. And through a friend, I heard that SIS was hiring. I heard they were hiring for security specialists. And given my background in education, which is actually anthropology and sociology, most people don't see how those two connect. But by studying human beings, you can really do well within the intelligence industry and within the security industry, because it is all about learning how to deal with and talk to and communicate with, and ultimately, from our perspective, secure human beings. And so it was through friends and family that I learned about the opportunity. And I started off, like everybody else, as a low-level security guard, minimum wage. I worked my way up through the company over time, and eventually was assigned to executive protection and threat assessment, risk management. And just to tell you a little bit about that, what my official duties were was to secure personnel, data, and property of VIPs that our company is hired to protect. So there's a whole lot of training that goes into that. And I became a security specialist for SIS, specializing in executive protection, also risk and threat assessment to our clients. Our clients are the companies or the individuals that we contract out with and provide services for. And it was in that context that I became aware of what I describe as a social engineering program and a research and development program that was being carried out by SIS and our clients in Seattle, the Amazon Corporation. And it was through moving up within the SIS hierarchy and working with more and more people as I was assigned to more and more assignments, I became aware of the existence of this program. And then little by little over time, I became aware of the extent of it. And it wasn't long before I realized how horribly out of control it was, how downright evil it was. Once I began to realize that SIS was experimenting on its own employees, my fellow security specialist, I was outraged. I later learned that my company was involved in a larger social engineering program that encompassed the entire city of Seattle. That aspect of the program was experimenting on the homeless population of Seattle, Washington, who were housed in DESC, Downtown Emergency Services Center facilities. And I later learned that they were indeed experimenting with, when I say experimenting, voice-to-skull, hive-mind, behavior modification technology that is frequency-based and directed at a targeted individual to basically control their entire person. And it was by moving up even more that I realized that this experimentation was going on against the general population of Seattle. And then just the average man and woman on the street, upper class, upper class, and even the flat out rich were having this technology used on them without their knowledge. As more and more information and details of the program became were made known to me, I became more and more outraged by it. And I spent a long time, because I had many friends within the security company. A lot of these people are great people. They're very good people. Not everybody involved in SIS is directly involved in experimenting on people. They're not all directly involved in gang stalking. I never was. I never partook in that. But I did partake in training that deals with tactics and protocols that are used normally for surveillance and counter-surveillance. But within that is all of the information and the know-how that you need to be able to gang stalk. And that is, in fact, what they are doing. And so over time, I became outraged, and I tried to play my cards right, wait for the right moment. And when I really just couldn't tolerate it anymore, when I found out just how out of control it was, I decided to object to my superiors in person. But within SIS specifically, what happens is they are experimenting on their own employees. So it's a long story. I'll try to get through it quick. But basically, people are selected from all over the country. We're talking other cities all over America. They are selected for many different reasons. Often it is because they are isolated. They don't have a lot of money, friends, or family. And they also tend to be people that are highly, highly intelligent. The aspects of this technology that they're interested in improving upon have to do with cognitive processes, processing information, and as a result, they want highly intelligent people to be targets of this program. They also tend to target people who are into what I would call alternative research, commonly called maybe conspiracy theories, people that disagree with the government, people that are into researching things like 9/11. Also, they are interested in people that are interested in technology. I have found a high percentage of targeted individuals to be people who either are interested in or have information on highly advanced technologies, usually having to do with directed energy weapons and frequency weapons, the exact kind of weapons that we're talking about here that are used in voice to skull and behavior modification, the works. There's many other aspects to the technology. But once these people are selected, They will have the entire gang stalking / voice to skull program run against them. This is detailed in my article. But they will be organized stalked. They will have career sabotage programs run against them to ruin their job. They will have character assassinations campaigns run against them in their neighborhood. They'll be isolated from family and friends as those individuals are turned against them. And they will be isolated slowly and slowly over time using the technology itself, as many of the people freak out, understandably, when they at first don't know what it is. Oftentimes, they end up going to psychiatrists and false diagnoses of schizophrenia, manic depression, delusional paranoid are rendered against this individual. And it turns out that that's a loophole in the law that they are using to take away people's constitutional rights, as once you are deemed mentally unfit to care for yourself, i.e. you're depressed, delusional, paranoid, etc., they use that, the state or the federal government uses that as an excuse to come in and say that they have to care for you. So I would warn all targeted individuals out there, please do not go to psychiatrists and allow them to render a diagnosis against you, because that is a dirty trick they are using to take away the rights of people all over the country. That's a great question. I do not have direct knowledge of that personally in terms of an individual, how they are selected. What I can speak to intelligently, though, is that each individual fits the general profile that I'm describing. So they're highly intelligent. They are able to be isolated by whatever means. They normally have some sort of what I would describe as a free mind. They're people that aren't, part of the crowd, so to speak, in the way that they think. They're outsiders. They're what the government would call dissidents or revolutionaries or people that may be a problem. Some TIs have said that this kind of profile that all TIs fits is empowered individuals, and I would definitely agree with that. But I cannot speak to how they actually identify an individual person. I think the general profile that I'm describing that fits the targets of this program is something that is generated high up within the program. We're talking at the federal government level. We're talking at the highest levels of this social engineering program, where scientists from all over the country and all over the world, they're looking at someone's genetics, they're looking at someone's cognitive abilities, they're looking at someone's genes, they're looking at someone's DNA, they're looking at people's social situation, they're looking at people's career. I've been very surprised that so many PhDs are actually targets of this program, and they're usually PhDs that have gone against the grain in terms of what academia normally teaches, usually within the fields of science and technology. And the reason for this is because people running the program want to cover up certain technologies and certain aspects of science that can lead through to tremendous breakthroughs. These highest levels of science and technology are the sole purview of classified sectors of our government and military. And as a result, the opinion is that the American people do not have the right to this information, and is in the national security interest of our country to keep it classified. And so that is the answer to your question. What I will do, though, is take this opportunity to distinguish really quickly between the larger phenomenon of TIs that is usually a person in America that's being targeted by the technology and is being gang stalked by members of their community, and the specific program that I am whistleblowing on. The specific program I am whistleblowing on involves the actual abduction of TIs from around America. They're put on a Greyhound bus and they are shipped to Seattle, where they are made homeless. They live in one of the homeless shelters where they are housed and experimented on with voice-to-skull technology. And then they are funneled into SIS to work as low-level security guards, where they are experimented on even more. So that is a specific program, and that's what I detail in my blog and my website. But because I am familiar with that program that utilizes the same tactics of gang stalking and the use of this technology against individuals, my knowledge on that program applies to what all TIs are going through. It's the exact same technology, and it's the exact same gang stalking tactics that are used against them. In terms of numbers, I know that there are right now at least 300 to 400 individuals in downtown Seattle that have been abducted from all over the United States, brought to downtown Seattle, and are being housed in DESC, Downtown Emergency Services Center, homeless shelters, and being experimented on 24/7. The numbers of SIS employees that have been experimented on, to my knowledge, is in the dozens. That's all I have direct knowledge of, though, about 24 to 36. And then nationwide, the estimates in terms of targeted individuals who still maintain some manner of autonomy and freedom and have not been brought to Seattle or enslaved completely by this, the estimates I have heard is anywhere from 1 to 2 million at the moment. And we're talking full-blown TIs that get the technology and are being gang stalked 24/7. Those are the estimates that I'm familiar with. This is discussed very much in the open within SIS and with some of the liaison contacts that I had with DESC, Amazon, and then also members of the military that are in a civilian capacity. One thing you have to understand is that within the security business, most of the people working there are ex-military and ex-intelligence operatives. And many of them, in fact, are still active intelligence operatives and have simply been reassigned to domestic duty to work with a private security company, specifically for the purposes of carrying out this highly illegal program that's being run against TIs all over America. So full-blown TIs, what I would call people that are getting the voice to skull, the frequency, and the organized stalking, I have heard is between 1 and 2 million, and that could be completely off. But one of the things I'm concerned about is the technology as it's being researched and developed in Seattle utilizes emotion manipulation and behavior manipulation without the gang stalking and without the voice to skull aspects. And so this use of the technology can be done very covertly to the point where the person it's being used against will not know that this technology is being used against them. And that is one of my main concerns and one of the reasons why I want to bring more light to this technology and to this issue, because this technology could potentially be being used against tens to hundreds of millions of Americans every day. I've mentioned in some of my podcasts how there are field effects where they will not direct this technology at an individual, but create a general field of frequency in a geographical area so that everybody that within that geographical area is feeling the effects of the technology. It's more of a general application of the technology instead of an individual specific application of the technology. But when you consider that use of it and the fact that it is used for emotion and thought and behavior modification, then we could potentially be looking at many, many millions of people across the country that are under the influence of the technology today, right now. The area of the geographical areas that I'm familiar with are limited to the size of maybe a downtown area of a city, so that the frequency that's being emitted by the device will have an effect on a geographical location, let's say downtown Seattle. And so what they can do is within this general field, they can broadcast a frequency that affects human beings within that frequency field and can induce a general mood of, let's say, happiness or sadness, anger, agitation, peacefulness. And in this way, they can have an overall effect in the city. And I have seen this done, and it is remarkable how effective it is, because you will walk down the street of Seattle and literally see people all in a bad mood, all at the same time, and they do not know each other. And then you go over a block or two to a different office building, and you walk in, and the exact same thing's going on there. It's very, very concerning. So within that, then, that overall bubble or area of frequency where everybody, let's say, is in a bad mood, they can still inject what would be a individual-specific frequency to the targeted individual themselves, let's say the homeless person in Seattle that's being experimented on 24 hours a day. So they will be under the influence of the general agitated mood or bad mood that everybody else is in, and then they can more further be manipulated by the frequency that's being directed solely at them. Absolutely, yes. That is exactly what the people running this program have in mind in terms of application of this particular feature. It is to, or at least it can be used to induce riots, for example, or stop riots. It could be very, very dangerous. And it's a great point you bring up about traffic patterns and auto accidents. I mean, this is messing with the innermost part of human beings, their emotions. And so you can imagine how irresponsible it is to actually manipulate someone into being in a bad mood and manipulate everybody in town into being in a bad mood. And then they get in their cars and they drive around where their own safety and other people's safety is at risk. It's a huge, huge problem. And you can imagine the applications of this. If anyone ever wanted to start a riot, if anyone ever wanted to increase the crime rate, and then, of course, you know, you can use it for the exact same opposite. You can use it to decrease the crime rate by making everyone passive. And that could have nefarious applications as well. If you want people to be passive and not pay attention and not take action, it can be used for that as well. So, yes, the mind is boggled by the possibilities in terms of what this could be used for. The radio frequencies, microwave signals, the entire spectrum of radio frequencies can be used within a certain range to produce all sorts of different effects. So the way it works is a device broadcasts a radio frequency, let's say at an individual, and that radio frequency will hook up with the resonance frequency of the individual's mind or body, or in this case, DNA. And what happens is once the resonant frequency is found in the targeted individual and the broadcast frequency matches up with that resonant frequency, those two frequencies interlock and they can be thought of as one frequency or one energy. And what happens is between the broadcast frequency and the individual that's receiving the broadcast frequency, once it's resonating, once they are resonating together, a super highway of frequency along which information can be sent is created. And so you can think of it just like fiber optic cables that you use to send signals over the internet that connect people to the internet. It's the exact same thing, only a wireless application of that. And so once you have connected the targeted individual with the frequency and they resonate together, then you have a perfect avenue upon which to send and receive information back and forth. And that's exactly how they manipulate someone's thoughts. They send voices into someone's head. They manipulate their emotions. They manipulate their behavior. And then that's also how they receive back from the individual in real time the vital signs, the emotions, the thoughts, what the person's seeing, what the person's hearing. And then all that information, of course, is rendered on a computer elsewhere via software, and it can be monitored and tracked in real time. It can literally stop your own thoughts from happening and replace them with other thoughts by sending thoughts to your head. And it's so sophisticated that you cannot tell where these thoughts are coming from. There's no way to discern that they are coming from somewhere other than your own mind. So you can imagine how bad this would be for people that don't even realize this technology exists and are having these thoughts, which they think are spontaneous, because being under the influence of this technology now, kind of having been on both sides of it, I am just amazed at the way it works. And I know that the thoughts that they beam into your head originate from the exact same place in your mind that your own natural thoughts originate from. So if I didn't know I was under the influence of this technology, then I would have no idea that anyone was influencing my thoughts at all. And that's exactly what it can be used for. It can be used to sway people in terms of their opinion, to make them go along with a certain agenda. It can be used to turn groups of people or individuals against each other for whatever purpose. And actually, this exact same technology can be used to not only influence the thoughts of someone, but also the voice box of someone. And it came to mind because you mentioned a politician. I heard that they actually used this on George Bush Jr. once, George W. Bush, when he was giving a speech because he could not remember his lines.
I have sent you a comprehensive energy plan to devastate communities, kill wildlife, and burn away millions of acres of treasured forests. Chabad save lives.
This is the type of thing that could be used to give a politician the words that they need to say.
I am a Zionist. You don't have to be a Jew to be a Zionist.
So that they will come across and deliver the message in the way someone else wants them to deliver this, deliver the message. So messing with people's thoughts is really, really concerning. And it is so advanced now that they can do it without people even realizing it's being done. And the thing that shocked me about it is it's not being done, you know, in a secret military base somewhere, and it's not being done in a controlled environment where people are being kept safe and separate. You know, the test subjects are kept separate from the general public so that nobody gets hurt. The entire city of Seattle has been turned into a massive proving ground for this technology, and it's being done right out in the streets. It's being used against people that are driving. It's being used against people that are trying to live in a city environment with the congestion and all the other people around that you have in that environment. And so the potential for accidents and things to get out of control and for people to get seriously hurt and indeed be killed by this is real, and it's happening all the time. And yeah, I think it just shows just how not only out of control this program is, but how completely unchecked the research and development aspect of our national security structure has become. They are completely immune to any oversight, to any consequences, to anything they're doing. And I just could not believe that this research and development part of this program was so advanced and was so widespread, and it was so out in the open in places like Seattle. And I encourage anyone that's in Seattle, please do go there, or that's near Seattle, take a trip there and spend a week, you know, on vacation. If you got the money to do it, I would recommend it, and visit DESC and visit SIS at 1415 Western Avenue, Seattle, Washington. Visit Amazon. Visit the Apollo, Nessie, Bigfoot, Cricket buildings. Visit these places and begin to look around and observe, and especially if you're a TI that knows the symptoms of the technology because you're an expert in it, because it's being used on you. You know just as much as I do. Well, maybe not the version that I'm aware of being used in Seattle, but you're getting a version of it, so you know what to look for. Go there and watch the homeless people. Watch their behavior. Look at their teeth, as all the people have their one of the effects, I'm sorry to say, for TIs out there is this technology will actually radiate the teeth right out of your mouth prematurely. And I know in Seattle and elsewhere, people are in their 30s, you know, that brush and floss every single day, that are having their teeth just fall out, sometimes whole. They're swallowing them in their sleep. They're choking on them. I mean, this has devastating effects on the physiology of the human being. But go down there and look. It's the signs are everywhere, and you will be fascinated, and your mind will be blown at just how out in the open it is. But I'm sorry, in terms of other places, I am aware of Aurora, Colorado. When I decided to blow the whistle and this technology was turned against me, a massive organized stalking effort was launched against me. And due to my training, I recognize the tactics that are used by these individuals, and it is high up. There is a military intelligence aspect of it. And I won't go into that any further other than to say that the people who are after me, who are monitoring me, are very, very good at what they do. They're the best in the world. And it's one of the things that has kept me so busy, and I've been so unable to really tend to anything else in my life. Even getting the word out is because I'm fending these people off and fighting back against them 24 hours a day. But I eventually ended up in Aurora, Colorado, right next to Buckley Air Force Base. And it turns out that this town as well is a major hub for this social engineering program. Aurora, Colorado is a town that has a large percentage of military personnel that live here. The adjacent base, also intelligence, families live here as well. When they're assigned overseas, this is where they would live when they're back on the home front domestically. And you can tell that this technology is being used on the people of Aurora, Colorado, many of whom serve in the military. And as I mentioned before, it's not only the general population of Seattle, the homeless and TIs, but this technology is being used against military families, people who proudly and bravely serve their country and sacrifice everything so that you and I can be free or at least we were able to be free before this this technology started being used against us.
Exactly.
Yeah. So it's here as well, and there are some other cities. It seems to be adjacent to military bases. I've heard this from a lot of people, and I've noticed it as well. If you have a massive Air Force base near you, Navy as well on the coast, there's a good chance that some aspects of this program are being run at the adjacent military base and is being used on the towns and the people around that base. And I was not aware either of just how widespread the security industry was in terms of its numbers and in terms of its power within the United States of America. You're absolutely correct. And it's a great point you make. A million personnel, I mean, just think of that in terms of standing armies. Look up some of the numbers on active military personnel in countries like Russia and China and the United States, the European Union, and you'll start to understand just how many, you know, 1 million people are and what can be done with that type of manpower in a situation like this domestically. So one of the things I think that is an advantage of the security industry, number one, it's private. So if you were going to roll out an army of gang stalkers across the United States to mess with people, to track people, to surveil people, to follow people, and to make their lives a general hell to live every day, then you would have to do it covertly. You would have to do it in a way that is not noticeable to the rest of society. And in fact, the tactics that are used by private security companies and gang stalkers at large are specifically designed to avoid detection, not from the targeted individual, but to avoid detection from the general public. And so it's a very interesting surveillance situation. It fits right in with other surveillance situations where they want the targeted individual to know that they're following them. And so in a normal surveillance situation, you do not want the person you're following to know that you're following them. They actually want the TI to know they're being followed because it has the maximum psychological impact. While at the same time, they need to do it in a way that your neighbors and your friends and your coworkers and your family do not know that they are doing this to you, because the entire point of the program is to convince everybody else that the TI is crazy. And so they need to surveil you and gang stalk you in such a way that other people don't notice that they're doing it. And so what happens is, I was actually with a friend when we were driving from Seattle, and I decided to leave. It was one of the last friends that I was able to have before this massive organized stalking campaign completely destroyed my life as well. And now I'm completely isolated as well. But I was driving with a friend, and we were being followed by people, obviously gang stalkers and military intelligence in my case. But they drive in regular vehicles. They're in modern trucks, SUVs, sedans, every kind of car. Many of them are Chevys. And if you're being, I think a lot of TIs have noticed this as well. Chevy seems to have some kind of a deal with these security companies. And I know, for example, my security company purchased most of their vehicles from a particular car company. So these are some of the things I noticed. But we're being followed by these people. And what they will do is, the otherwise unmarked car will have military stickers on it. They'll have license plates that say Air Force. They'll have stickers that say Marine Corps or Army. And generally, the personnel as well fit a general description. A lot of them have tattoos. A lot of them are young. A lot of them appear to be, you know, very young, maybe a military type of a look, only with kind of a gangster type of a vibe to them. And I think that's for the purposes of intimidation. And I know that is one of the psychological aspects of what I learned at SIS in terms of gang stalking, is the image you're projecting is very important. It is scientifically planned down to the last detail to have a very specific psychological effect on the target. But anyway, we're driving and we see all these cars around us, and they all have military and Marine Corps, Air Force. And my friend said, you know, is that the Air Force following us? Is that the Marine Corps following us? Are these people, you know, military? And it's a very good question. And they are trying to give that impression that who's following you is active military. And of course, that's not the case at all. They are private security contractors, or they are at least intelligence operatives that are operating domestically under the cover of being a private security contractor. And the reason they put those stickers there is to give the impression they're military. And so what you have a lot of times, the way they get license plates that say Air Force engraved on them is they are former Air Force. The way they get some of these insignias on their car, they are former Marines, and they are now retired. And after active duty, a lot of them need jobs, and they are being hired by the thousands each and every day to staff private security companies all over the country. And private security companies and private investigators, what they do is they investigate, they surveil, they follow, and they carry out covert intelligence and investigative operations domestically in a way that can't be protected. It's the perfect way to carry out gang stalking operations against GIs. And the number one rule in intelligence work and in security work, in terms of at least people that are going to be surveilling the public, is to remain undetected. And so in terms of a profile, they go out of their way to hire people of diverse ethnic backgrounds, each gender, all age ranges, more or less. There's obviously limitations if you're too old to be able to follow people on foot. But I've noticed a lot of the mobile details, a lot of the mobile assignments will be carried out by the more elderly of the private security contractors, because they can't be operating in an inner city, for example, on foot, walking up hills and so forth. People with disabilities as well cannot do that. So there'll be mobile units. Static and mobile units are the two basic units you have within private security, and then they're assigned to different assignments. But yeah, as far as the profile, they are ex-military, they are ex-intelligence. Many people, like myself, have no ties to that, but they start off low in the company as a security guard, maybe executive protection, maybe risk threat assessments. Maybe they have an IT background, so they get in that way. And then they're trained little by little to be led into the gang stalking and kind of the covert aspect of the company, which is involved in this social engineering program domestically to target TIs. And so what you have is, in terms of a street gang stalker, the kind of people that will have constant contact with the TI on a regular basis for the purposes of being known as gang stalkers to the TI, they will have a certain profile physically. The men will often be very strong. They work out. They're buff, for lack of a better term. They will have a generally intimidating demeanor. Although when you talk to these people, of course, they could be completely nice, very, very decent people, most of them. They're doing their job, and I don't think there's any way they have to get out of it, because they all know if they come forward and they say something, then they're going to get gang stalked as well. And unfortunately, I'm proving that by the way that I'm being targeted and gang stalked, and the technology is being used against me. But this is the general appearance that they give, and so it's to be intimidating. And there's a very fine line between kind of the military intimidation and what you would call a gangster or a thug intimidation. And both aspects, of course, are there on purpose, and gang stalking has been designed specifically to have both aspects there. They want you to believe that your country hates you. They also want you to believe that you're in great danger all the time. And the thug gangster aspect of the vibe that they're giving off is there specifically for that reason. And so you can start to see how psychologically this is going to have an effect on someone very, very quickly. If they're under the impression that the military, their own government, and then a bunch of thugs are following and chasing them around the country, it has a devastating psychological effect. There is a precedent, I will say, that I'm aware of for hiring people that have displayed a certain moral ambiguity concerning certain issues. For example, within certain private company security companies in the Seattle area, there are a lot of ex-LAPD. In fact, when the Rodney King riots went down and a lot of the scandals that went on in Los Angeles, the LAPD went through several stages of reform, and anybody from LA, of course, will remember this. And the people that were forced out of LAPD ended up almost exclusively going to work for private security companies. So you can imagine the types of characters that ended up in private security companies when the LAPD didn't want them anymore. Also, people that have criminal backgrounds are often coveted for gang stalking type of assignments. The reason for this is that they do not mind, obviously, mistreating other people. They have what could be called a criminal mentality. But it's also important to note that despite the unsavory characters that are within this, the entire point of it is a hands-off policy. And this is very, very evil the way they're doing this. So, I mean, not in any way defending them. I'm making the opposite point. The hands-off policy is in place by private security companies and gang stalkers, the federal government, and everybody else involved in this, specifically to have the excuse and say, we didn't actually physically harm this person. We never struck them. We never shot them. We never hit them. We never did any physical harm to them. So everything that's done by this program is meant to have a psychological effect, and the psychological effect is meant to complement the effect that the technology is having on the individual, so that they are brought to a place in their life where they're isolated, they're broke, they're unemployed, they have no family, they have no friends, and nobody in the general public can track or trace anything that's being done to them because the technology is remote and it's wireless, and there's usually no physical signs left on the individual that anything's being done to them. And the interaction with gang stalkers within the community, there is no physical evidence that any gang stalking ever went on. They are specifically instructed, you know, do not slash anyone's tires. Don't, you know, vandalize their house. That is not the point of the program. The point of the program is to have maximum psychological effect and leave the minimal amount of evidence. And so you can see how this hands-off policy, and this is a standard term that's used within the private security industry in terms of what security guards and security personnel are supposed to do in terms of a threat. You are supposed to maintain a hands-off policy at all costs until you absolutely must intervene physically or with use of force. And so that's kind of an industry term that's been adopted by gang stalkers as a hands-off policy against the TI, so that when that person ends up in a hospital or ends up physically deteriorated, they can't turn around and blame the gang stalkers because they were never, quote unquote, touched or physically harmed by them, even though all of the harm that's done to TIs is done by the gang stalkers, it's done by the federal government that endorses this program, and it's done by the technology, and therefore the gang stalkers, the technology, and the federal government is liable and responsible 100% for everything that's been done to the TI. Nobody advertises, you know, on Craigslist that we're hiring you to harass and torture people. It's just not done. And I can speak personally for myself, and I can speak personally for the people I worked with at SIS, that when you do first find out what's going on, you are disgusted by it. You cannot believe that this is what's going on. There is also a very quick, almost a peer pressure induced acceptance of it that causes you to say, you know, this is pretty cool. And I'm just being flat out honest here about the psychology that's going on within these people's minds. It's pretty cool. We're part of the group. We're part of the massive army of people that is going to be okay no matter what, because we're on the right side of this, because we're the people with all the power. We're the people that with ties to the intelligence agencies. We're the people with ties to the government. We're the people that are going to be okay no matter what, because, you know, we are willing to violate the law to get away with whatever we want to get away with. And our superiors and our bosses are as well. So as long as we make them happy and we do our job, we're going to have a pretty good life. And I can tell you that this is exactly what is done to people almost immediately upon the revealing of what is really going on. They are offered a series of incentives. They're offered, first of all, acceptance into the group. They're offered acceptance into what will be the future of America, that you will be set, you and your girlfriend, or if you're married, you and your wife, your husband, your children are going to be taken care of. You're going to make a lot of money. You're going to have brand new cars every couple of years. Your kids are going to go to the best schools, and you are going to be connected, for lack of a better term. And at this point, it really does take on almost an organized crime feel to it, because what you're dealing with are people that are pleasing their boss in order to do something that is absolutely illegal. they're monitoring and harassing and torturing and sometimes leading to the death of American citizens. They're violating their civil rights. They're violating their human rights. They're violating basic human decency. This is horrible stuff that's being done to people. And so you have to understand the psychological aspect that goes into convincing gang stalkers and people that are part of the program to do what they're doing. The psychological operation that is run against gang stalkers themselves and people that participate in the program is just as advanced, if not more so, than the psychological program that is run against TIs. It absolutely is. And so what you have is this very intense psychological program that's run. In fact, one of the things that I'm not sure people are aware of, but I'm trying to cover this on my site because I have direct knowledge of it, hive minds, voice to skull, emotion manipulation behavior, modification technology is being used against the gang stalkers themselves and against people in the program. And it is being used to assist them in doing their job, specifically to take away their conscience, specifically to take away their empathy and their sympathy for the individual, for the targeted individual, so that they don't feel bad, so that they don't feel guilty about what they're doing. They are, you know, many times intelligence agents and soldiers are trained to get the empathy and the sympathy out of their system, because you're going to be asked to kill someone for us. You're going to have to go on the battlefield and shoot someone, and you're going to shoot them just because we tell you to shoot them. And so a lot of the stuff that goes on in basic training and in terms of training intelligence operatives is designed specifically to make sure that people will pull the trigger when they need to. And stuff like human decency and love and compassion and empathy and sympathy and caring for your fellow human being does not enter into the decision-making process. And so the exact same thing is done within the program, within the Voice to Skull gang stalking program. And it is done not only by peer pressure and direct training, it is also handled by the technology that can manipulate the people's emotions to turn off empathy and sympathy and love and care and compassion, and to turn on what I call almost a mercenary hired gunman mentality.